are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, everybody. Welcome and good afternoon to week 7 of Art 100. My name is James Scarborough. It still is and will be for the rest of the term. Again, we're live and you'll see the phone number and you're going to see an email address. So you can call in if you're bold, or you can write in responses to questions of the day and let's take a walk. And again, I read all the emails, all your responses when I get home after the broadcast, and they're fantastic. I could write a book based on these things, and I just wish I had time to read all of them. I think we had 27 of them last week, which is fantastic. So keep up the good work. Like I said, even if I don't get to them during the broadcast, I do read them, and you will get credit for them. We did a survey last week to see if we should do a proper midterm exam review or if we should just open up the class and, you know, do a bunch of let's take a walks, questions of the day, ask me stuff, a bunch of extra credit stuff. And the results are in, and about 75% of you wanted to have a midterm exam review, and that's fine. So the way it's going to work is next week we're going to do architecture. In 2 weeks, we're going to do the review. And the review is going to consist of essentially a PowerPoint presentation. It's going to have all the concepts, all the terms, and all the processes of everything we've done through chapter 13. We're not going to have images because you're not going to have images in your exam. And I have made a PDF of that already available in exam practice on the left vertical in Blackboard. And you'll also see that I've posted the questions for the midterm. Now, I want to go on record as saying again the reason why I did that. This is an introduction to art class. This is not an upper division class. It's not art history. It's what I think they used to call art appreciation. And in the old days, for example, when I took it, we'd have to memorize hundreds and hundreds of images for exams. We'd have to memorize the title, the author, the medium, and the date. And then we'd have essay questions. And nothing was open book. And it was incredibly vigorous and rigorous. And it was a lot of work. The big difference now with being a student is you can easily look up all this stuff on your smartphone, easy. You could even take the midterm exam on your smartphone. You honestly could, the way that it's set up, open book, multiple choice. So what I'm focused more on is the qualitative experience of art, and I'm setting forth a few simple, basic precepts, and I call them walkaways that I hope you're gonna walk away with at the end of the term. Namely, art is everywhere. Namely, you can either look at art knowing nothing about it and just base it on your own life experiences, cultural experiences, stuff like that. Or, if you want, you can read about it, you can talk about it, you can look up videos on it. And it's the difference I make, the distinction I make between people who go to the museum and you see them all the time. People walking around looking like this, kind of going, interesting, and they slowly walk around the galleries looking at the art. And then there's also people that have the headphones in and they're getting the guided tour. They go to this piece, skip a couple, go to the other one, and they're getting very, very interesting, informative, often authoritative discussions of the work on display. Both are perfectly valid ways to look at art. So mostly, I just want you guys to engage in the work. So that's why you're going to find, I don't know how many, we're going through chapter 13. I think there's probably 10 or 11 Word documents with questions. And you might think, well, piece of cake, I just have to memorize everything. Well, it's not exactly as easy as that, because each of you are getting different exams, and each exam is randomly generated. So you're going to have 30 questions, but you don't know what the 30 questions are going to be. And the midterm, I believe there's 258 possible questions. So you're going to do a ton of preparing. So the three ways you can prepare for the class, well, actually there's four. You can watch these videos on YouTube of me talking to you. You can look at the PDF of the PowerPoint presentation for the review I'm going to do in 2 weeks. Or you can go to the questions and look at those. And you can, for heaven's sakes, read the book. They're all valid ways to do it. The only thing I'm going to say, and we're going to go over this during the review, but the only thing I'm going to say is, and this is good advice for all your other classes when you get into college, you got to have a test-taking strategy. You have to be prepared. And it's not just enough to know everything about everything. You have to be able to anticipate questions and all of that stuff. And perhaps what we're doing here is a little baby step into getting you to do that. Anyway, so if you have any questions, email me, call, whatever, but go to exam practice, left vertical, and you're going to find all that stuff. We have a couple of news items here. And the first item is, I don't know, not your parents, probably your grandparents, maybe. They used to collect, I bet, perhaps, things called Wedgwood ceramics, plates, bowls. They were fantastic. They're very characteristic. We have an image of a couple of them right now coming up. And you can recognize them from a mile away because they're always going to have this, I don't know what it's called, I call it Wedgwood blue. It's going to have white designs. The subject matter is very classical. It's going to be mythological. It can also be historical. I've seen one of Washington crossing the Delaware. I think we've got one. Yeah, there's another one. And you can just see how classical and beautiful and just elegant these things are. It's always blue. It's always white. And it's like, okay, life is cool. Life is great and everything. Well, there is a company called Calamity Ware. And I think that probably gives you an idea of what's about to come up. They've got their own take on it. And I know you can't see it very well, but this is their rendition. You'll notice the same blues, the same whites. And although you can't really get into it, there's a zombie apocalypse happening in here. And we've got another slide too. Can we see the next one, please? And there we got some Bigfoot guy, and people are being eaten and everything. So I think it's a very hilarious update or interpretation on a very classic, restrained, elegant piece of fine china. You can call it sculpture if you want. It goes from these classical bucolic scenes to these crazy scenes of chaos and pandemonium. We also have this really cool story of a Spanish guy. His name is Justo Gallego. Now, I don't know how many of you know that over here, not too far from what, well, you're all over the state, not too far from the broadcast studio, is this extraordinary thing called Watts Towers. And I should have brought in an image of it. It was made by an immigrant named Simon Rodia, and he built it by hand. And he built it using scraps of things. It's this massive, massive monument. And I love the idea. Some guy, he's not an architect, he's not a contractor, he's just some guy living in Watts, and he decides to build this beautiful thing. Well, as I said, this guy's name is Justo Gallego, and in the outskirts of Madrid, for the past 53 years, he's been building his own cathedral. by hand and by himself. You can see how it's not finished, but you get an idea of what's going on. You got the arches, you got the arc right there, or the columns, you got the arc, you got where the windows are, and we've got one more image of that coming up. And there it is from the outside. And it's just, it's extraordinary. It's a cathedral. I think it's the most fantastic thing. Again, like Mr. Rodia with the watchtowers, we have a guy who's building a cathedral. I couldn't find information on if it's going to be a, as they say, a functional cathedral, but he's building a cathedral, and all I can say is good for him. And then finally, there's a museum in New Jersey called the Montclair Art Museum, and they've got a show. Now, these are the shows, and I will always be the first to admit that even though I've spent my life in the art world one way or the other as a critic and a curator and a museum educator, museum director, there are certain things I just don't get. I don't doubt the significance of it. I can discuss this particular piece, art historically, because it is significant, if not a little interesting, but I just don't get it. I don't know what it's doing in a museum. Totally a personal opinion, but what it is, the artist has made a bunch of things, and they're all laid out on this simple grid, okay, where things are. And then you can see what some of them kind of are. There's a chair right there, for instance. So what he's done, he's left instructions for the viewers. So you come in, you pick up the pieces off the grid, and you assemble them in various ways that the artist has determined he wants them you to do them. In other words, he's giving you the ingredients for a work of art, and then he's giving you the recipe on how to put it together. I don't know what the art here is. I don't know if the artwork itself, because it's a conceptual piece, if the artwork itself is the idea of what he's doing, his idea is giving people instructions and material to create work. I don't know if the artwork is the thing itself that we would make as we go in. And I've always struggled with this when I've reviewed shows of conceptual art, because honestly, and if some of you guys have some intuitive explanation for this, I'm all ears. I don't understand how you determine whether a piece of conceptual art is good or not, because we're certainly not looking at it in the ways we've discussed in terms of themes or visual elements or design principles. Do you base it, your analysis, on the idea or on the execution? Anyway, I think that's pretty interesting. This week, we are continuing with the processes part of the class. We're going to discuss graphic design, and we are going to discuss sculpture and installation. Now, when we talk about graphic design, we're talking about something fundamentally different than everything we've done before. Because when you talk about graphic design, and when I say graphic design, I mean advertising, billboards, print ads, movie ads, everything. It's all done for a very, very specific purpose. It's to sell a good, it's to sell a product. It could be for food, the labels on food cans in your market. It could be labels on clothes. It could be on packaging. But the point is, everything we've looked at before, painting, drawing, prints, photography, movies, they've all been open to countless interpretations based on your particular experience and your interest and what you got out of this. The big difference now is that there's only one. There's only one thing that it's meant to do. The graphic designer works for a client, and there's a message they're trying to convey. They convey it with the means that we've talked about, the artistic means, but we don't, well, we're meant to see it a particular way. So that's what we're going to be doing today, that along with sculpture and installation. We have a question from Brandon. Why are we looking at modern day images that relate to art? Thanks, Brandon. We are looking at modern day images that relate to art because this is an art appreciation class, and I figured that instead of talking about textbook famous stuff that you would see in a museum or in a gallery, and by talking about it in class like this, it's kind of static. When I do these art news things, what I'm trying to convey to you guys is that art is part of news. I mean, we don't have gossip pages for art. We don't have reality shows about art. But art is a newsworthy item. And it's very interesting, I think, I hope you guys find it interesting, because it shows there's many, 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 many more artists than the artists that we're going to study. There's artists that you've never heard of. There's artists that make stuff in very different ways. So that's the reason that we do that. And also because starting in 2 weeks, or the week after the midterm, we're going to be going through art history. We're going to be looking at art from literally the Stone Age, from Stonehenge, all the way up to 2016. And so it is in keeping with my premise that art is everywhere, and art is not just something that you see in museums and things. It's something that's noteworthy and newsworthy, and therefore, I hope, of interest. I hope that answers your question, Brandon. We have questions of the day. First question of the day is as follows, is coming up. How do you decide to buy something? How does its graphic design help you, try to help you decide? Now, what I'm interested in when I conceive that question is you buy things that you need, you know, clothes, food, some kind of transportation, whatever, and then you buy things that you want, and they're not necessarily the same thing. Do you necessarily need another pair of shoes? Do you necessarily need, you know, a new car every couple of years? Or do you do that because the advertising convinces you to buy something? So what we're looking at with that question is, what does graphic design do in terms of motivating you to buy one pair of shoes as opposed to another? How does it motivate you to buy one cell phone instead of the other? One of the students in my face-to-face class yesterday brought up a very interesting point. She said, and I wasn't even aware of it, and then I went back and I checked out these videos. Apparently, unpacking videos are a huge thing on YouTube. So you can get a phone, you can get a computer, you can get a laptop, a tablet, you can buy clothes, you can do all sorts of stuff. And it all is, it's getting the package and then opening it. So you're looking at the packaging and seeing how it's put together. Not the object itself, but the package in which it comes. And I guess the example, the way that, because when I first heard that, I was astonished, but I guess it makes sense. And we're looking at what they call the sizzle and not just the bacon. The bacon is the thing itself. And it's especially big with cell phones. But anyway, so that's the first question. The second question is, what works of sculpture exist in your local area? What purpose do they fulfill? How do you respond to them? In other words, wherever you live throughout the state, you have civic, I know you all have civic centers, and then usually your library is going to be right next to the civic center. And very frequently, you're going to have sculptures in front of that. It's going to be some person who was one of the founding fathers of the city, a famous judge. It could be a Civil War hero. It could be anything. So what kind of sculptures do you have? You could also have public sculpture too, which is more artistic as opposed to documentation. And so what kind of works exist, and what purpose do they fill? Is it to make you proud that you live in a city, in a state, in a country? And then how do you respond to them? And actually, do you even notice them? You know, I know that especially in outdoor sculpture, sculptures tend to be a favorite nesting place for pigeons. And do you even notice the sculpture? And if you do, have you ever read it? Have you ever read the little thing that says this is the name and this is why they're famous? We have a phone call. Let's take that phone call, please. The phone call. Hello, Philip from Orange, who's the only one who's called this term. How you doing, Philip?
I'm doing good. I'm calling in for question of the day number one.
Okay, why do you buy something? How does graphic design help you influence the way you're going to buy something?
Before I buy something, I like to compare products online. First, I usually look at the products with logos that I recognize. Graphic designers try to help me decide by using the elements of bright colors to catch my eye and movement to keep me on the page and interested in their product.
Excellent. Okay, so you are convinced by the outside part of the object. I mean, what it looks like, the colors. And so whoever's in charge of the graphic, whoever the graphic designer is, they've done a good job if they get you to focus on the colors, and that would convince you, at least in some point, if not the cost itself, to actually buy that particular good, correct?
Correct.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Very good call.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. And then finally, we can take a walk, and it's with a very famous image. I don't know if you've seen the image, I'm pretty sure. I don't know if you know it was done by James Montgomery Flagg, and that it was done in 1917, and that it was done in direct response to America's entry into the First World War. Now, we can look at this in terms of as an artwork. I mean, the foreshortening of that hand right there, and you can see the finger, it could almost poke you in the eye. The colors are very symbolic, red, white, and blue. It's patriotic. We're going to be looking at typeface, and that is very key. You, as in red, i.e. a million people can be looking at this, but because that red is large, because that you is large and it's red, it's saying you particularly and nobody else. It's a recruiting poster. You see it, it's supposed to motivate you to go and enlist in the armed services to go fight in Europe. And how does that affect, how effective is that as a, not a work of art, but as an example of graphic design? I mean, the very specific purpose, and there's no other purpose here when Mr. Flagg created that image, it's a lithograph, is to get you motivated to enlist in the armed forces. And so that's, you can just call, and I would love it, you just start talking. You don't have to have an answer written out. You just go, well, the finger, the stern expression, the patriotic colors, the star, the font, the typeface, the colors, all that stuff. Anyway, so that's that. And we have a response to the first question from Emily. Thanks, Emily. Graphic designers use scale and proportion to emphasize important text in advertisements, such as, and she's got it in caps, in huge font, and quotation mark, huge sale, or new items. They also use bold colors and large text to grab consumers' attention and convince them to take a look at the item the company is trying to sell. Exactly. Companies such as Apple are always sure to take advantage of the media and release videos that circulate online promoting their new phone and its newer, better features. That's excellent. And in fact, we're going to look at a video, a very famous video for, it's funny, it's a very modern effective looking video, but it's actually for one of the older iPods, one of the big clunky ones. They don't make them anymore because you now have the iPhone, but that's exactly what it is. They use typeface especially, and that was great. Oh, she's got a second response here. This is for the sculpture. There are several sculptures in my local library depicting children reading books. The artists are all from my city, which creates a sense of community when you view the sculptures and contributes to the reading environment of the library. Yeah, excellent. It's not necessarily a world famous sculpture, not necessarily a world famous sculptor, but the fact is the fact that you've got people reading books placed in a library, it emphasizes without words, that's exactly what the purpose of the sculpture is. It's very good. Philip, who is very, very, very active. Congratulations, thank you. He has a response to the question of the day, and I love this. Unfortunately, we don't have many pieces of sculpture in my local area of Orange. I did see the statue of John Wayne at the Orange County Airport yesterday. I think, like many other sculptures, its purpose was to be a memorial to John Wayne, even though I don't know much about John Wayne. Well, Philip, as a matter of fact, I grew up in Orange, and I used to fly out of that airport when it was a municipal airport, a dinky airport like the Long Beach Airport is now. And that John Wayne statue was massive. It was in front of the airport because it wasn't. Orange County Airport, for those of you who don't know it, it looks like LAX. It's massive. In the old days, when I used to use it, it was small. The buildings weren't that small, so this sculpture of John Wayne was very significant. And also, as a matter of background, John Wayne, the movie star, he also played football at USC in the 20s. He lived in the Back Bay of Orange County. He was very, very famous in the area. So it's showing one of its local heroes. Anyway, Philip continues. And he was a big guy, a huge guy. In the movies, he's always a cowboy, a war hero, and he looks just like the football player that he was. I was impressed with how large this cowboy was and the detail it had, like the creases in his pants, his fingernails, and the buckles on his boots. Yeah, they were showing him as he was in real life, which was very big. And to make you more impressed by him, they would show him with all these details, like the creases in his pants and everything. That's really good. Okay, we're going to get on to a little bit of material here. So we're going to talk about graphic design first. And again, like I said, its purpose is to convey a specific message, to make you do a specific thing, whether it's buy something like clothes, whether to do something like enlist in the armed forces. Now, the roots of it goes back. There's two major developments that made this possible. And again, when I say graphic design, what I'm talking about essentially is advertising and a little bit of public relations, but it's the ads you see everywhere. The first major development that made this possible was the invention of the printing press, because if you didn't have a printing press, you couldn't have newspapers or magazines or anything, and you couldn't have the ads. An equally important thing a couple hundred years later was the Industrial Revolution. And again, alas, this is not an economics course, but very briefly, what came out of the Industrial Revolution was the fact that you could make clothes in England, for instance, and then sell them in Spain. I don't know if that's what they did, but you could do things. You could make all sorts of things, including food, and you could ship them all over the world. And that's how England became very famous and very rich in the 19th century. And that's why they said the sun never set on the British Empire. So what happened is all of a sudden, you could live in a small village somewhere, and you would buy your shoes from the cobbler, your clothes from the dressmaker, your eggs from somebody, everything was local. You didn't need to go beyond the confines of your city, town, or village. Once the Industrial Revolution came along and things became, well, relatively speaking, more globalized, now consumers, i.e. us, we had our choice. We could choose those shoes, those shoes, those shoes, or those shoes. So what's going to distinguish that? Well, advertising. So you're going to see the ads. Like Emily said, you can use massive print, you can use colors to draw attention, to differentiate your particular item. So what we're going to talk about when we talk about graphic design, and we have a slide about the different things in graphic design, are going to be, well, I'll read them, signs and symbols, typography and layout, word and image, motion and interactivity, and graphic design and art. That last one, it's the same thing we did last week. We had photography and art. So we had artists who used photography as a form of art. And as you're going to see in a little bit, there are artists who use graphic design as a form of art. We have a bunch of responses again. Great, thank you. We're going to read one from Katarina. Thank you. I think that graphic design influences how we decide to buy something because it's a part of the marketing strategy of the product. Graphic designers use different shapes and colors to grasp people's attention and persuade them to make a purchase. Absolutely correct. I have friends who are graphic designers, and they are parts of marketing teams. And again, whether it's a good, whether it's a service, there is a strategy to get their product in, not only in front of as many eyes as possible, but to make it stand out in as many different ways as possible using the various elements of graphic design. First thing we're going to talk about are signs and symbols. And the most basic concept of that is a picture is worth a thousand words. Symbols convey information. The most powerful symbols are going to be logos. And there are many famous symbols, and again, without words. The first one is the yin-yang symbol. It's very, very old. It's Chinese. It shows the balance of the universe in very simple form, just like that. That's a very powerful symbol. It's recognized universally. But then we also have logos, and I think the study of logos is very interesting because I think we take it for granted. We have this, Roger Cook and Don Chinaski, they introduced, there's a bunch of signs that you see at airports and train stations, and they're kind of hard to see. Well, Philip just came back from the airport, maybe he saw these. But when you see things like that, these all mean very specific things. They're universal. That's Red Cross or some kind of first aid, the ladies' restroom, the men's restroom, taxi cab, bus, and a bar of some kind. That's a restaurant, no smoking, no parking, etc., etc. And the reason that that's significant is not just that these are powerful symbols, they're universal symbols. So you can go into a place, and I've been to the Middle East, and those are the exact same symbols. So even though the signs above the men's restroom are written in Arabic, I would see that, and I go, okay, well, I'm not going in the wrong restroom, for instance. Then we have these images by Paul Rand. And the other thing that I think we take for granted is, because I know I used to do it all the time, you see a logo and you go, oh, okay, well, that's obvious. That's Channel 7 in the LA area. That's Westinghouse. That's UPS. That doesn't exist anymore. That's the Next computer. That's the one that Steve Apple founded that company when he left Apple the first time. They're all done by some guy named Paul Rand. And the point is, they say everything you need to know. You see that UPS symbol on the big brown truck, you know exactly what it is, United Parcel Service. And again, a picture is worth a thousand words. You just see the symbol and you know exactly what that means. We also have typography and layout when you talk about graphic design. And so when they started mass producing goods, a very general statement, during the Industrial Revolution, and they made posters and all sorts of printed material, they had the need to standardize the fonts. And it used to be done manually, and it used to be quite artistic and precise. Here we have letters from a treatise on measurement by Albrecht Dürer, who's also a very famous artist. And you can just see how, so letter A, the letter D, how gorgeous the handwriting is. It's a very specific, standardized font in the old days. Of course, now it's done, a lot of it is done on the computer. But one of the things, if you're a total book nerd like me, when you read analog books, paper books, and you go to the very back and it's got the biography of the author, and you go back again further and it says, this book was written in the Baskerville font. The Baskerville font was created by the name of the guy, the date. It is known for its elegance, ease of reading, all of that stuff. It's a huge deal when you talk about that, because when you're reading something, for instance, you want fonts that are very simple and easy to read. If you want something for fun, or you're just messing around, just go to your Word document or your Pages document, do the drop-down window on the fonts, and you're going to see insane fonts. I just saw a font the other day called Farmer's Daughter Fonts. I had a student in a class at Long Beach last term, and for a graphic design project, she invented, and it was fantastic, a zombie font. The zombie font had all the letters, capitals, small letters, and the numbers, and they were all comprised out of bones and body parts, because it is, or was after all, a zombie font. The other thing that's cool about having typography and layout is it makes things a lot more legible. So there used to be a train that would go from New York to New Haven, and we have a schedule of it coming up. And so in the old, this is the original one. It was very cluttered, very busy, okay? It was very hard to, relatively hard to read. So they decided to redo it, okay? Now look how clean it is. It's got a lot of white space, it's got headings. It's just, it's easier to read that. And by the way, in case you're wondering, this is kind of outside of the range of this class. When you start doing resumes, one of the things they're going to tell you, because resumes are, after all, besides conveying all of your information, they are a form of graphic design. And whatever they're going to tell you, they're going to tell you it's got to be legible. The headings have to be clear, like that's your name. And you got to have a lot of white space that makes it easy to read. That is not easy to read. Anyway. Okay, we have a response from Brianna. Hello, Brianna, thank you. Graphic designs try to help us decide what to purchase by drawing us into whatever they're trying to sell. Correct. In order to draw us in, graphic designers need to be aware of what is going on in pop culture. That's actually very astute of you, Brianna. Most of the time, we will buy something if we think it's popular or in style. Also, graphic designers need to know which fonts, colors, and lighting to use. If the item they're selling doesn't look organized or well displayed, then we're not likely to spend money on it. Correct. That's absolutely correct. If it could be the greatest, say it's an iWatch or whatever they're called, it could be the greatest thing, but if it looks awful, I mean, it could function great. If it looks awful, if the packaging is kind of crummy, the odds are probably very good that it's not going to sell, especially with people, young people of this generation, because they're more keenly attuned to things like that. Sage. Hello, Sage. I'm still a bit young and don't really buy things, but what I usually see in ads is they make things pop. That's actually the word they use, pop. Using maybe dull or not as amazing colors in the background, while having the main object in the middle popping out more and being more vibrant. Mm-hmm. Also, using things people usually like and then adding their product to it, into it. Like, for example, people like watching Avengers, and so having an ad with one of the Avengers drinking Coke catches the eye. It draws more people in. Yep, that's very true. That's called product placement. And there's a lot of movies that get paid a bunch of money if they'll use something. I don't know specifically what, like an Apple computer versus a PC or something, but that's exactly what it is. Humor, music, and sounds also have an impact on that. Sometimes, when the creators make a funny ad, people are usually able to remember it easier and share it with friends. Yeah, if it's memorable, you're going to share it with somebody, and that's the whole point. It goes, I think that the word is viral. People talk about it, it generates a buzz, and people are going to buy it. And that's why you create ads that pop in the first place. Or when they add a catchy song to it, or possibly make their own catchy phrase song. For example, Red Robin, yum. Huh, what is that? Is that, I'm gonna guess. It's catchy, and people will even repeat it to their friends. Now I'm curious, Sage, Red Robin, yum, is that a restaurant? Is that an ice cream flavor? I don't know, but anyway, very good points. So now we're gonna talk about word and image. And we've looked at signs and symbols. We've looked at typography and layout. And now there's a place where they come together. And that is in, for example, ads, proper ads. So Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec is a very famous French artist at the end of the 19th century. And he's very well known for painting scenes of music halls. And that is very distorted. That's a little distorted. Okay, well anyway. So he made an ad for a music hall called La Goulue at the Moulin Rouge. Moulin Rouge is a very famous nightclub in Paris, was a very famous nightclub. And the point of it is, it's the marriage, and in my opinion, the very effective marriage of words. So look at the red, and then the black, and then the black shadows, and everything, and then the grayish fellow there, the white woman, the red. Everything ties together perfect. As Emily was saying, it used the large letters to catch your attention. Use the caps to give you more information on the piece, but then you combine it with the images. And so the overall impression of it is, it's an effective combination of word and image, for example. A little more recent, but it's still kind of funny now when I think about it, because this iPod is, it's prehistoric. It probably belongs in the Smithsonian. There's an ad. There's an ad company on the west side of Los Angeles called TBWA Shy at Day. And they did a very, very effective ad campaign for the iPod. And so this is a still, and you would see billboards of it all the time. You notice there's no words. It's just a silhouette of men, of women, dancing, moving. They're black. The backgrounds are always going to be a vibrant color, lavender, green, whatever. And then a very effective use of tone is the white iPod and the white earplugs. And we've got a 30-second clip of that, too. It's just music. It's just somebody, a silhouette dancing to the music. And it's a very effective combination of word, image, and motion. So we're going to look at that now. It's for 30 seconds.
Buy it, use it, break it, fix it, trash it, change it, mail, upgrade it, charge it, point it, zoom it, press it, snap it, work it, quickly erase it. Technologic. Buy it, use it, break it, fix it, trash it, change it, mail, upgrade it, charge it, point it, zoom it, press it, snap it, work it, quickly erase it, write it, cut it, paste it, save it, load it, check it, rewrite it. Buy it, use it, break it, fix it, trash it, change it, mail, upgrade it, charge it, point it, zoom it, press it, snap it, work it.
You'll notice that that ad at the beginning for the first 26 seconds out of 30 seconds, it just shows somebody dancing, holding what we will know, already know is an iPod, and it's creating this image of this very hip person, this very nimble dancing person with some, which was probably at the time very hip song, just dancing, having a good time with their iPod, and only in the last second or two do you see the word Apple. So, as Sage was saying in a prior comment, it creates a tone or a tenor of hipness or fun or whatever it is, and you go, oh my God, I got to get one of those. And then it's almost like at the very end of the ad, they're saying, oh yeah, we're Apple, go buy one. So, there you go. We're going to read comment by Gracie. Hello, Gracie. I think that art in the form of graphic design plays a very big part in marketing. Graphic designers are paid to make the targeted audience notice logos, bright colors, and designs before they look at the product. You know, Gracie, that's exactly what I suspect goes on when you're in a meeting, with a marketing team meeting. They figure out, you brought up this key thing, the target audience, which is called the demographic. For instance, you're not going to be selling the Apple iPod and creating those kind of videos and print ads for somebody who's in their 60s, for instance. So it's a very conscious decision. People of a certain age, whatever the age is, they're going to be attracted to the sounds, the music, and the movement, and things like that. Anyway, very good. We're going to skip over, you guys, the motion and interactivity, and we're going to go to graphic design and art. As I had said, there's artists who use components of advertising as art, too. I think the most famous one, and I don't know if you've actually made the connection, but Andy Warhol. Andy Warhol started off life as a graphic designer. I believe he was in Pittsburgh, that's where he's from, and he designed ads for shoes, and then he became this insanely famous artist. So he's very famous for his Campbell soup cans, and we have an image of those. There's the beef consomme, he's got the tomato cans, but this is not an ad. I mean, quite frankly, it could be an ad. It looks like an ad. The fact that it's originally in a gallery and now it's in museums all over the world makes it art. But Andy Warhol clearly drew upon his graphic design background to create works of art like that. There's another artist named Barbara Kruger. Barbara Kruger wanted to create artwork that was where the words and the image would combine in an aggressive way. And you know what? We can't see the words on the image. Is there some way to compress the image to show? Okay, we're not going to have the words on this one. It's a very intense looking woman in profile. Her eyes are in shadow. She's very, very intense, okay? And then what you have here are the words in very elaborate, like, oh God, there's my graphic abilities. Your gaze, oh, forget, I'm not even gonna do it. The typography of it along the side, your gaze hits the side of my face. And as she had said, she wants the word and image of this piece to be aggressive, and that's exactly what it is. So it's an image of a woman who is very, very, very aware that she's always being looked at. Presumably, okay, there we go. That's better. Thank you. Your gaze hits the side of my face. Black, white, black, white, black, white, black. It's like a caption for this. She's very aware that she's being looked at, and she's doing it with words. It's a very effective combination of words and images. We're going to do two more comments, and then we're going to take a brief 10-minute break. Kristen writes, and Kristen, thank you, hello. Designers often use colors to draw people to buy their products. Brighter colors draw your eye and make the item seem new and more exciting. True. And also, Kristen, did you know when you go to the supermarket, to a lot of supermarkets, and say you're in the soup section, you know, the Progresso, Campbell's, all the different kinds of soups, apparently the salespeople, the people that come in to sell it, they try to get the market to place their cans at whatever eye. I think eye level is officially at 5'7". I think that's the height. But there's an ideal height in a market. So when you buy, and you got like 10 different kinds of chicken soup, you want the one that's right in front of you. So you don't have to look up, reach up. You don't have to bend down to get something. And they're also going to make it as bright as possible. And so soup cans tend to be very bright there. Oh, sage. I had asked what Red Robin Yum is. It's a catchphrase for a restaurant called Red Robin, and they usually have these ads for their restaurant. And at the end of the ad, a bunch of people together sing Red Robin Yum. Thank you for that clarification, Sage. And with that, we're going to take a 10-minute break. We will be back shortly. Thank you.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The Certificate Program in Social Media Strategies and Content Marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
My name is Zenea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
one of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what Hux 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is the advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities? I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, both of our anecdotes are about, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
The benefits of this model involves the faculty because we can be closer to one another and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The thematic approach and building through a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future Hux students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the five terms of this program.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everybody, welcome back to the second part of the class. We're about to dive into sculpture and installation, but before we do that, I was very curious about this jingle that Sage mentioned, so we're going to play it. And by the way, this is not to say that CSUDH is recommending you go to Red Robin. This is simply an example of some sort of graphic design advertising. So now that we've done that, can we play the jingle, please?
Bottomless fries with every burger, all day, every day, starting at $6.99. Not to get all legalish, but that's like from now until forever. Or until your wife tells you to stop.
Red Robin.
Yum.
Very good. Yeah, see, that has a lingering after effect, like a Cheshire cat smile. And you would carry that around, and then you want to go back to it. Anyway. We are going to talk about sculpture now, sculpture and installation. We're going to talk about the methods and materials of sculpture. They include modeling and casting and carving. They're coming. Modeling, casting, carving, and assembling. Those are the basic ways. And even within that, there's two real ways to make sculpture. The additive way, and where you're adding clay to something or assembling something, or the subtractive way, where you're carving something away or casting. But anyway, we'll get into that. We're going to talk about why the human figure is such a key subject matter for sculpture. You don't see the proportion of figurative sculpture to abstract sculpture remains very, very high, unlike with painting, for instance. I have no scientific data on the proportion of figurative art to abstract and non-representational, but sculpture still tends to be figurative. And we're going to talk about time, working with time and space. So as I said, there's two ways to make sculpture, but there's also two kinds of sculpture. The first one is sculpture in the round. And by that, I mean, we're going to look at a piece by Louise Bourgeois called Mama, and it's going to come up. And so when I say sculpture in the round, all I mean is, so this is obviously in a plaza, it's in a public space. It means you can walk through it, you can go around it, you can investigate it from all these different angles, okay? You can even look up into it. So sculpture in the round means it's available to your eyes. Another kind of sculpture is called relief sculpture. And that is sculpture that comes out of a surface. We have a very interesting sarcophagus wall from the late classical period of Mexico. And it's not especially clear. Well, anyway, so it's the lid of a tomb is what this essentially is. And if we had the details, you would see there's all sorts of figures and activity going on there. But you can only see it from one angle, and that is looking down onto it. Even if you're looking at it flat, you're just going to see the indentations of it. So sculpture in the round means you can look at it from a bunch of different angles. Sculpture in the in relief just means you can only look at it as it emerges from a surface, from a sarcophagus top, or even from a wall, which is the more common way of looking at it. As I'd said, there's two major ways to make sculpture, and I'll say them again. You have the additive way. So when you're making something, you're adding material to that, and that is modeling and assembling. And then the other way, and I think it's important to realize that, because if you can just keep that in your head, you realize there's four kinds of sculpture, two processes. So additive and then subtractive, which again is carving and casting. So when you talk about modeling, you do it as a kid. We all make sculpture. We all make sculpture out of clay or Play-Doh or whatever it is. And then you can use tools, you can use your hands, but it's something you're adding the clay to make a form. An example of that is a figure of a voluptuous lady from the late classical period in the Mayan culture. And I mean, it's simple. They just built the body up using clay, and they smoothed it out. Okay? We have the casting method, and an interesting, if not quirky, example of that is an artist named Jeff Koons made a unbelievably famous bronze sculpture of, yes, that is Michael Jackson and his little buddy Bubbles. Now, when you describe the casting process, it's very, very labor intensive. I mean, to model something, you just need clay or something that sticks together, you bake it, you dry it, whatever you do. Casting, especially bronze casting, and even more especially large sculptures, is very, very difficult. And it's also not a very easy thing to explain. And so instead of me just confusing the daylights out of you, and probably confusing myself, is we're going to look at a brief video on a method called the lost wax bronze casting process. And you're going to see why it's called lost bronze in just a second. This will explain it better than I can. And it'll also give you an appreciation of when you see the sculpture of the kids reading in your library, for instance, or whatever, you'll realize how much effort actually goes into that. So if we could see that video, please. Intensive nature of the lost wax bronzing process. It's called lost wax process because they, as you saw, they have a clay model, cover it with wax, fill it with plaster, and then you heat it, and then when you pour the hot lead or the hot material in, it melts the wax, and then you have the finished thing, and then they finish the patina on it. And they were just making something like that big. In a couple of minutes, we're going to look at a massive one by a French sculptor named Auguste Rodin. And you're going to, so just think of that process, how much work that would be, and multiply it by like 8 or 10. It's absolutely extraordinary. We have an interesting comment about the second question of the day by Jacqueline. Thank you, Jacqueline. There are many sculptures around where I live, but there is a Buddhist temple that we pass on the freeway that is so exquisite that you just have to take a moment to stare. The building in its entirety is one big sculpture. I've never been in it before, but I can imagine that being up close, I'd be able to spend hours admiring the amount of detail in the temple. That, it sounds really interesting, and I'm wondering where that might be. Next week we're going to do architecture, and you're going to see how it ties into sculpture, because architecture and sculpture have a lot in common. But anyway, so casting is an example of subtractive sculpture, i.e. you have the wax model, you melt the wax, and you've got the bronze sculpture left. We have carving, which is subtractive, and it's just as simple or as obvious as modeling is. We have a colossal head, an Olmec head from Mexico, and it's just a massive rock. And it starts off as a massive rock, and you just start carving, okay? So it's, you have the all these have different tools, different methods. And then you have something called assembling, which might not seem as obvious to you, but assembling means that you're placing things together, you're combining things. So we have an artist, an American artist named David Smith, and it's called, he has a piece called Cubi 12 in Roman letters. And so, yeah, he's cast the shapes like we just looked at, but he's also assembled them. So he's taken pieces of each, okay? Each of these are separate, and then he just put them all together again. And then we have an image by Roxy Payne called Conjoined, and it's the exact same thing. It's a tree, that's a tree, and then a fake tree, a sculptured tree. And it looks just like that one, except it's silverish or bronze or whatever. This has tentacle branches, and so does that one. So they combine, they touch, and they form a work of art. And I think that looks really good in that environment, as a matter of fact. Now, as I was saying just a few minutes ago, why is the human figure so popular when we're talking about sculpture? And there's three reasons for it. The first is it conveys a sense of permanence, a sense of, you know, humanity. As long as we've been here, it makes us think about how solid we are on this earth. And a perfect example of that is a sculpture of two people. I'm going to pronounce your names, Menkaure and Cameron Netby from Egypt. And as you can see, it's a man and a woman, presumably a husband and a wife. And because this is Egypt, we're going to presume he is a pharaoh or some kind. And then that's his wife. They have their feet on the ground. They're solid. They're permanent. And they're not going to go anywhere. They're thousands of years old. So one of the reasons why we use the human figure is for a sense of permanence. Another reason we use it is for a sense of posterity. And this is that sculpture by Auguste Rodin called The Burghers of Calais. And it's a commemorative sculpture of some very heroic people, men, who gave their lives to save the city of Calais. It's a city in France. They sacrificed their lives, and so they were martyrs. And they're all in these different positions of agony and despair and everything. So they can commemorate something like that for posterity. And also, I just want to point out, these things are huge. I think they're 7 or 8 feet high. Just imagine how much labor went into making that, how long it took, and just the physical effort. And then finally, another reason the human figure is so prevalent in sculpture is because the human figure possibly can best show a sense of spirituality. So here we have an image called Kuya preaching, and it's exactly what it looks like. He's preaching, the words is some kind of a mantra, and those are figures coming out of his mouth. He's carrying his simple tools around. It's a very solemn piece. It's a very spiritual piece. And it just makes you, whatever your religion is, even if you don't have one, I think you'd be hard-pressed to say that that particular piece is not spiritual. The other thing that I've been wondering, and I can't find anything on it, so the methods we've been talking about, the four processes, they've been around for thousands and thousands of years. And I know people who actually, they print things. They can print, for example, you can print parts of cars. You have a software program, just like you print a document. You have a printer with whatever the material is, and you can start printing stuff. And I'll be very curious to see in the years to come, and I bet there's artists right now working on this, if there's some way that they're going to be able to print something that comes out as a bronze to cut through that whole labor-intensive process. All right, so now we're going to talk about installations. And the installations are going to consist of two kinds. They're going to be the ones that are in nature, and that's kind of where nature sculpts itself. And on a personal note, those are the ones that I absolutely love. And then there's ones where artists create installation pieces inside a room of a gallery, in the room of a museum. So the first one we're going to look at is called Serpent Mound, and it's near Locust Grove, and it's in Ohio. And you know, when you look at this, you wonder, was that there all along? That's the serpent right there, okay? It's been there for ages. It's part of some ritualistic thing. We don't know who did it, but the reason it's called Serpent Grove, A, you've got the trees, but B, the convexity in the grass right there, it looks like a massive snake right there. So that's an example of somebody has used nature to sculpt itself. The other one we have this British guy named Andy Goldsworthy, and he's got a piece called, and I just love this piece, it's called Reconstructed Icicles. So this is real snow. I mean, this is a landscape. This is outside somewhere. But he's created icicles that come up the tree like that. It's like this little ornamentation. We're going to look at a brief video, 1 minute and 53 second video of Mr. Goldsworthy's work.
Growth, time, change, and the idea of flow in nature. When I make a work, I often take it to the very edge of its collapse. And that's a very beautiful balance. Understand that state and that energy that I have in me, that I also feel in the plants and in the land. The energy and life that is running through the flowing through the landscape.
I think one of the reasons that I have always responded to the work of Andy Goldsworthy is because I race in mountain trail races, and therefore I train on mountain trails. And there's so many times, it's just all over the place, all over Southern California, and I'll come across stuff. I remember the one he's building that thing and then it all crumbled down. I've seen a bunch of things like that, and I've always wondered to myself, did somebody make that, or is that just the way that it was? I like running into art in unexpected places, like, you know, up in Chino Hills State Park at 8 o'clock in the morning, as opposed to going to a gallery opening in Culver City on a Saturday night. We have this extraordinary photograph, or it's actually an image of Fireflies on the Water by Yayoi Kusama. And when you look at it, okay, well, she's there too. But these are actual fireflies. I mean, God knows how many thousands of fireflies they are. This is the same location for the image, but the photo's taken a bunch of different times over time. So each photograph captures a bunch of different fireflies, and that's just, I think, in other words, it's over time. The photo keeps getting taken and taken and taken of something in the natural world, and it's layered and textured and kind of archaeological that way. And it's just a gorgeous photo. We have an artist, actually, I just realized, Louise Bourgeois is the person that did that Mama, that big spider photo, or sculptor. That was an example of sculpture in the round. She also has this installation called Red Room Child Interior, and it's a room. It's in a space. It's set off with those doors right there, and it's called Red Room because all the objects in it obviously are red. The objects are on pedestals or plinths, okay? They're on platforms, and they're on shelves. And presumably, there's some sort of meaning in the color red. There's a symbolic reason why they're red. And the objects themselves presumably have some kind of meaning for her. And by extension, if we go into it, you know, we'll respond to the red and to the arrangement, the composition of how the pieces are placed, and then maybe even to some of the things that are placed in there. There's an artist named Dan Flavin, and he has a piece called, it's called Untitled, to Karen and Walter. Dan Flavin is an artist from a movement, and it's from Los Angeles, actually. It's called Light and Space. And that's exactly what it means, that you can't see it in this, you don't get a sense of it in the image, but these are light bulbs, okay, fluorescent lights. And the sculpture part of it is the light. It's giving off, it's creating different tones and shades and densities of light as it comes out. So the sculpture itself would be the light bulbs, this rectangular shape of the bulbs, but it emits the color, it emits the light and affects the color and the personality of everything in the room. And then finally, I don't know if you guys have heard of this guy named Christo. He was married to Jean-Claude, who unfortunately passed away a couple of years ago. But he's done these massive, massive scale projects. And we just discussed one on a as a news item a couple of weeks ago as a wrapped island or whatever it was called. And he did one in Central Park called The Gates. And this video lasts for 5 minutes and 7 seconds. We're not going to have enough time for that, I don't believe. So can we play it for about two minutes, please? I'll give you a sense of this massive project. They've done these all over the world. They've wrapped the Reichstag building in Germany. They've wrapped islands in Florida. It's fascinating stuff. And what I especially like about these artists that we've just done, these installation artists and landscape artists and things, is they're creating art. I mean, they're making things that have visual attraction and appeal, but they're doing it outside the confines of a gallery for the most part, especially Andy Goldsworthy, and they're using nature as a partner in what they're doing. We've had some very good comments, and I'm going to read David's really quickly. There's a 25-foot wooden sculpture called Harmony. It was created by chainsaws. It's the collection of all the native animals that live in my city. Yeah, see, it's everything is very personal, very private. It shows everything in your city. Anyway, next week, architecture, we'll talk about the midterm. Have a good week. Take care. Thank you.